Okay, good morning, everybody. I'd also like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this conference. I'm the first speaker of this conference, so I'd like to give you some general physics. So many of you came from in the far away, so I hope you gradually wake up during my talk. I'm from Riken Center for Emergent Materials Center, and at the same time, I belong to the Kabul Institute for Theoretical Sciences in Beijing. Until March, I was in the Advanced Science Research Center, Department of Energy Agency, and before that, I was in the Institute for Material Research, Tokyo University, Sendai. So still, I have some activities in these places as well. Okay, so the title of my talk is Spin Mechatronics, Albert Einstein meets Spintronics. So you might wonder what the title means. So this is what I'd like to discuss in this talk. This is the content of my presentation. As the introduction to spin mechatronics, I'd like to show you the Einstein-Dukas effect and the Barnett effect, the both of which was discovered in 1955. And then I'll show you a very recent application of Einstein-Dukas effect and Barnett effect. And then in the second part, I'll introduce you the spin hydrodynamic generation in liquid metals. This is a new electric generation based on spintronics. This is a list of my co-workers. I'm mostly in Advanced Science Research Center, my former place. There are 12 people in theory and experiment. But you see here, recently, 6 people moved to the other places. That means these people in this field have very good mobility. Recently, I have started a new project of this spin mechatronics with these people, and I'll show you some of the results of this new project. Okay, first is the introduction to spin mechatronics. Albert Einstein considered that the origin of magnetism might be a kind of angular momentum of electrons before the discovery of quantum mechanics. If so, when the magnet is magnetized by applying magnetic field, the angular momentum will be transferred to the rotation of the sample, and sample will rotate. So he did the experiment. This is his first and last experiment, together with a young colleague, Dukas, and he applied magnetic field in this iron rod, and then the iron rod rotates. Okay. In this way, sorry. Turn off. Or do I use this? Okay. So, come back to this. So, Einstein proved that the origin of magnetism is some angular momentum. In the same year, the Barnett rotated an iron rod, and he found iron rod is magnetized by rotation. So, rotation is sometimes called Barnett field. You see, this is the interaction Hamiltonian of the rotation omega and the angular momentum spin. But rotation is an accelerated motion. Therefore, to derive this interaction, we need a general relativistic quantum mechanism, although this is very simple. But we consider the non-relativistic limit. Then we introduce this unitary transformation. J is the angular momentum of the angular momentum plus spin. Then we introduce this unitary transformation to the Hamiltonian, and then we get the interaction between orbital and the rotation, and the spin and rotation. As you see here, there is no coupling constant. This is completely different from the spin orbit coupling, which is of order of 1 over mass square. But we need to observe the coupling, this coupling in the rotating frame. So we have, we know the various phenomena due to these interactions. One of them is the Foucault pendulum. We are on the rotating Earth. Therefore, this pendulum has an additional Coriolis force, and we have Foucault pendulum. This is one of the examples of that interaction. And another example is the gyroscope. We introduce angular momentum in this gyroscope, and this angular momentum is changes. Then this angular momentum is transferred to the rotational top. This is the result of this interaction. Now we are interested. These are the classical case. Now we are interested in the quantum version of this interaction. Now. Electron has a spin and orbital angular momentum in an ion. And so the total angular momentum is the sum of spin and orbital angular momentum. But magnetic moment is of an electron is different because we have the G factor 2 on spin. So, but in the usual transmetal magnet, the orbital angular momentum is quenched by the crystal field, and the small amount of the orbital momentum is recovered by the spin of this interaction. But this recovery is quite important. So this recovery is observed by the Barnett effect. Actually, a long time ago, Kittel and Wambrecht studied the recovery of the orbital angular momentum in iron and cobalt. And the recovery is given by epsilon. This is the deviation of G factor from 2. And then they obtained that the G factor, epsilon, the deviation of G factor epsilon is 0.1 and 0.21 in iron and cobalt bulk magnet. So this is a long time ago. So now we recently applied this technique to a granular nanomagnet. This is a TM picture of granular nanomagnet. And the nanogranular iron cobalt particles are dispersed in the magnesium fluoride and aluminum fluoride. And this magnet is very important because this is a transparent magnet in a certain range of the concentration of nanoparticles. So we introduced the nanogranular magnet in this capsule, and we rotate it. And the three field is measured by magnetic sensor around here by using, and we analyze the three field by using this simple model. This is a result. And yeah, so epsilon, the recovery of the moment is 0.31 in nanogranular magnet, which is different from bulk iron and bulk cobalt. In these cases, the recovery epsilon is 0.1 and 0.21. respectively. So in the granular magnet, the orbital is not a biplayer, and we have to study the orbital from the beginning. So this is the new direction which we are extending in this technique. Another example of the Barnett effect is seen in Fermi magnets. And you see, the Fermi magnet has two compensation temperatures. One is the angular momentum compensation temperature, and the other is the magnetic moment compensation temperature. This is a magnetization function temperature in holmium iron garnet. You see, we have a magnetization zero point at the magnetization magnetic moment compensation temperatures. And the angular momentum compensation temperature should exist at this temperature, but in the measurement of the magnetization, we do not see anything. But we applied the Barnett effect in this Fermi magnet, and we have obtained this picture. So you see, we have two zero points of the stray field or magnetization, at this point. And this is the angular momentum compensation temperature. In this way, by using the Barnett effect, we can directly measure, observe the angular momentum compensation temperature. This is a new application. And in particular, between these two compensation temperatures, we have a very strange magnetization behavior like this, but I'm not going into the details. Okay, now we move on to the second topic. This is the spin hydrogen generation in liquid metal. This is a new electric generation based on spintronics. And this, the first paper was published in 1916 in January, but interestingly, this work was reviewed in, presented in News and Views in Nature Physics and Nature Materials and Science before the publication. This was the first, my first experience. Okay, let me first show the what is the spin current. The upper figure shows the electrons with spin up and down. The electrons flow in the electric field, but this flow is independent of spin. Therefore, we do not see any spin in the flow, and we have just a flow of a charge. This is the usual charge current. But as seen in the lower figure, in some reason, up and down spin electron flows a different way. Therefore, in this case, the charge of electrons are cancelled and we have just flow of spins. This is spin current. And you see the spin current has no charge. Therefore, spin current is free from Joule heating. So we consider spin current is one of the solutions to the heat problem in electronics. This is the reason, one of the reasons why spintronics is so popular. And the spin current and charge current are easily interconverted by using the so-called spin Hall effect. In the left, we introduce a charge current in this direction. Then the spin electrons are scattered by spin orbit scatterers by heavy elements or some topological insulators. Then upspin electrons go this way and downspin electrons go that way. Then we have the spin current in the perpendicular direction. And in the right, we introduce the spin current in this way. Then we have the charge current in the perpendicular direction. In this way, we can convert the electric current to spin current and the spin current to electric current. Therefore, we manipulate spin current, and if necessary, we convert the spin current to electric current. This is the recent direction of the spintronics. Okay, in the spin mechatronics, we view an electron to be a microscopic rotor. That means upspin electrons is considered to be a rotor with right rotation, and downspin electron is considered to be a rotor with
left rotation. When we have this view, then we have this idea. This is the spin current. This is the spin current is the flow of angular momentum. Then spin current is injected into a liquid metal. Then the spin angular momentum is transferred to the liquid metal. We get vorticity like this. Or if we have a vorticity in the liquid metal, then the vorticity is transferred to the electron spin and we get a spin current. So this idea is realized in this system. This is the flow of mercury in the quartz tube. So we introduce pressure and the liquid mercury flows in this way. But when we look at the inside in detail, we have a rotation of fluid in this way, in that way. So rotation of the velocity is the vorticity. Therefore, we have the spin rotation coupling or spin vorticity coupling here. And when vorticity has a gradient, then we have the so-called Stern-Gerlach effect, like a magnetic field gradient. And then the electron spin has a field force, and then we have the spin current in this direction, which is perpendicular to the flow direction. And once we have the spin current, then the spin current is easily converted to the charge current, and we get electricity. This is the idea. And this is the experiment setup. We introduce the pressure, and we have the flow of mercury liquid. And we measure the voltage like this during the flow. And now we consider the turbulent flow. Here, the Reynolds number is in this range. This is the example of the result. We introduce the pressure and the mercury flows. And during the flow, this time, we get a voltage, electric voltage in this way. So this is the spin hydrodynamic generation. This is the new electric generation. When we reverse the direction of the flow, we have the voltage sign is reversed in this way. So signal is reversed by the reversing the flow direction. The right-hand side shows the voltage as a function of time under various pressure to introduce the flow. You see the with increasing pressure, the voltage increases. We have changed the size of the length of the tube and also radius of the tube. And so then we have various result. But once we plot the result in this way, namely this way, we have the universal curve. So everything's consistent with this experiment result. Namely, the voltage is proportional to the velocity square. This is a turbulent flow case. Now, we reduce the size of the tube, and we have a region of a lambda flow. And this inset shows the velocity of the fluid as a function of pressure, we have linear relation. And this is the voltage, observed voltage as a function of velocity. You see, we have linear relation. So in the lambda flow case, voltage, induced voltage is proportional to the velocity linearly. This is a summary of the result. In the lambda flow, the voltage is proportional to velocity. On the other hand, in the turbulent flow, voltage is proportional to velocity square. The reason is the following. In the lambda flow, vorticity gradient exists in the whole fluid region. On the other hand, in the turbulent flow, vorticity gradient exists only at the edge of the tube. This is a difference. Therefore, we have that difference. And this figure shows the converging efficiency as a function of the Reynolds number of the liquid. Converging efficiency means the electricity, obtained electricity divided by the flow energy. So and this is turbinate region, and this is the lamellar region. In the lamellar region, we have quite good efficiency. Although the induced obtained voltage is still small, but it's, we can improve the efficiency more. Okay, so so far I have shown the liquid mercury case, but another liquid metal at room temperature is gallium indium tin alloy, like this. So we repeated the study in this case, and we have more or less the same result in this case as well. Okay, so in conclusion, in spin mechatronics, this is in this spin mechatronics, we view an electron to be a microscopic rotor. Then we have a new physics. And rotation, this is the coupling between spin and rotation. But this is, although this is a very simple expression without any coupling constant, but because the rotation is generally accelerated motion, therefore, we to derive this one, we need a general relativistic quantum mechanics. So this interaction has a deep physics, and we have a much room to apply this coupling. So in there are many mechanical rotation around us. One of the examples is a surface phonons, which is called a Rayleigh wave. So this is a rotating wave at the surface. Then, because you, by using this rotation, we can induce spin current. This is one of the examples of the applications. And also, recently, our spin hydrodynamic generation idea was applied to the Koch gluon plasma generation in Brookhaven. Off-center collision of gold-gold nuclei produced very large rotation, which is 10 to 22 hertz. And because of this rotation, Koch gluon plasma was induced in this way. And this way, coupling of angular momentum and Ricard rotation can be used in various fields in physics. So, in conclusion, 100 years later, Professor Einstein meets spintronics. This is my message. Okay, thank you very much.